by building trenches in our plantations to ensure that water is channeled to our plantations. We do the mulching, and also we are introducing agroforestry. We support from Trias. We have given out 5,000 tree seedlings. These are broad-leaved trees, like the mangoes. We have the cashew nuts and the jackfruits. Yeah, we have given out those ones because we know that in our region, they're starting the oil mining. So to reduce the carbon effects. We are encouraging farmers to start as complementary enterprises so that if you have crop residues, can be fed to animals. If you have animals, you can use cow dung for manure. Even chicken droppings can also be helped. You put it for, can use it for manure. Then we encourage swamp conservation. We don't allow farmers to go into the swamps. And also because many people tend to grow vegetables, but we ensure that nobody encroaches the swamps. And we also, yes, also we're encouraging ourselves to have manures, organic manure to fertilize our plantations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. And sorry to push you a little bit. We have 7 speakers, so we need to limit the everyone. So from Africa, from Uganda, we go to France. And Thierry Devaux is a board member at Agri Agency AFD, is also a farmer. We discussed together this morning about your farm and what you produce. So I give you the microphone.
Okay. So my name is Thierry Devaux. I am a French farmer and board member of AFD, which is member of Agricole. AFD mobilize the French farmers by means of strengthening, supporting and training through partnerships with farmer organizations in Africa and in Caribbean. I have 2 parts in my small presentation. First, my farm organization in France. And second, the AFD contribution to young farmers organization. 13 years ago, the hope to produce differently and to share my work led me to create a farm organization. The choice of soil conservation agriculture was revealed following the strength of a testimony of a farmer who was blossoming on a video. A new farm organization of 7 farmers in France on a surface of 800 hectares grouped in a GIEE, that means economic and environmental interest group, meets today the initial objectives, that is, maintaining the high level of production, 50% reduction in fuel consumption, thanks to the optimization of the equipment and the cessation of tillage, of plowing, 40% reduction in fertilizer consumption by using livestock effluents and introducing legumes in the rotation in permanent cover and between 2 crops. 30% reduction in the use of phytosanitary products due to the regeneration of the soil. We have now a very high biologic activity of the soil with abundance of earthworms. These good results were only possible thanks to the strength of the farmer working together that has clearly defined a sustainable development objective. The support of professional agriculture organization in technical support, as well as some regional and national funding, facilitated the transition. Today, I can say I'm proud to show many students and many farmers that a farmer organization makes it easier to implement climate change mitigation actions by limiting greenhouse gas emission and storing carbon. So about AFDI, as member of AFDI, I want to show it's possible to build the future of sustainable agriculture with young people. AFDI is working with several farmers' organizations, mainly in Africa, to build support system for young farmers. The objective is to enable young people to set up farms that are resilient to climate change. In Madagascar, with a farmers' organization called SO, AFDI creates attractive conditions for young people to set up their own farm with building a business plan for the young person project, mediation with landowners to facilitate access to land, intermediation to facilitate access to means of production and credit, technical and management training for the young people, mainly training in agroecological practices. Also, easy access to innovation and digital technology, access to the service of the cooperative to benefit from collective storage and marketing. This set of measures allows young people to envisage a more serene future despite the constraints of climate change. This type of system also exists in Togo, where a network of education agroecological farms has been set up by Regepat, an organization of young farmers. Action in favor of young people and agroecology are taking place in Mali, Burkina Faso, and Cambodge. In each case, it's a question of taking into account the climatic challenges in order to effectively support young people when they set up. Furthermore, they are trained for advocacy, for youth inclusion and decision making in the farmers' organization, and make them proud to become farmers. Thank you.
Thank you, Thierry. Esther, I think you could take this microphone. I will just introduce you quickly. So Esther is the secretary, Esther Penunia, Secretary General of the Asian Farmers Association for Sustainable Rural Development. So to you, Esther.
Thank you. Good afternoon to everyone, and thank you for being here. And let me quickly just introduce to you APA, or Asian Farmers Association. We are a regional farmers organizations. Our members are national family farmers organizations in 16 countries, around 13 million members who are engaged in crops, livestock, fisheries, forestry, herding, and pastoralism. And we are in the Asia region. And when you talk about climate change, when you look at the top 10, for example, those who have severe floods and severe typhoons and severe droughts, you can always find at least three Asian countries in the top 10 of the most vulnerable in climate change. You know? So that's the situation of family farmers in Asia Pacific. It's very real. It's very real. So, and we have conducted a lot of consultations already on how to adapt to climate change. And for us, climate change is resilience, climate resiliency. And the image that comes to us when we say the word resilience is the bamboo. The bamboo, because the bamboo is very pliant. You know? When there's strong wind, it just bends and bows. And then when the wind is gone, it goes back, it springs back to its own feet. So that is what we want to have, you know, in terms of climate, of adapting to climate change, that we be resilient in this. We accept it that it is there already, but we want to bounce back when it hits us and maybe reduce loss and damage to us as farmers, and maybe also gain some opportunities if there are, no? If there is like opportunities, no, in climate change. So in our consultations, we have many stories, but let me highlight some of the dramatic cases, okay? So first, we have a farming couple, and they were awarded lands under the government's agrarian reform program. And with the help of the National Farmer Organization, of which they are a member, they practiced integrated, diversified, organic farming. So in a 2-hectare piece of land now, before you can just see rice, monocropping. But now after 10 years, you can see fruit trees, you can see flowers, you can see fish ponds with the ducks swimming and the ducks eating the insects on the rice fields. Now you will have, they have some goats and they have chicken also and some pigs. No? So there is integrated crop livestock in that particular farm. And because of this kind of integrated diversified farming, they reduce loss when there is a climate unpredictable weather. So maybe for this season, the bananas will fall down because of the climate change, but there is the ducks that lay eggs that they could sell to the market and that can give them income. So it's diversified, this integrated diversified organic farming practices lead to more income and lesser inputs, lesser costs for buying, for example, chemical fertilizers. No? So the result is that the farming couple is saying now we are able to send children to school and we have food. No? Unlike before when we just had rice as our plant. No? The second story is on fishing. So we were hoping we will have here Ka Dodoy Balyon. No? He is our Ramon Magsaysay awardee. Ramon Magsaysay Awards in Asia is like the Nobel Prize. He is a small scale fisher folk, but even then he was able to lead his village and his town and then his province to plant mangroves. No, because at that time in 1994, when he was still very young, there were fish cages in his village and then the fish got lost because of the too much chemicals that were fed to the fish. And so they left. So mangrove reforestation, so from 50 hectares to 500 hectares of mangrove plantation from one village to more than three municipalities in one province. And what is the result? The fish catch was 7 times more today. And then the hours spent in fishing is 2 times shorter. So this is very good, no? Sustainable fishing. Yes. And lastly, women. No, women farmers. So they do solar pumps. They do rainfall insurance. They have a cooperative that gives savings and credit to farmers. So, and this we saw when we went to Vietnam with FFF, with IUCN and AgriCord. We saw a women's cooperative doing, for example, agrotourism now. So what is the common denominator for all of these things? We see that if farmers are organized and these organizations are strengthened and their capacities are built, so these organizations are able to help their individual members adapt to climate change. And that's, we think, partners like the Forest and Farm Facility with IUCN and AgriCord and IIED to in helping us build the capacities of our farmers, not only the men but also the women, and now the young farmers being helped by our organizations to adapt to climate change by building sustainable agriculture based enterprises. Thank you for giving us the time.
Thank you, Esther. We will now have a short video that show how important is farmer empowerment if we want to work on climate, climate action and mitigate climate change. Okay. 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 We'll next, our next speaker will be Tina Juvo. She's Executive Director of Food and Forest Development, Finland. Tina.
Thank you. It's nice to be here. Nice to see you. I find these COP meetings always kind of a chaotic. So, and we are fighting for the time with all the other side events. I would like to crystallize my messages in three. We talk about empowerment, we talk about financial flows, and we talk about how we get the knowledge and support to those farmers who need that. The video that you saw, that's done by AgriCord Alliance. As Esther was mentioning, it's part of the Forest and Farm Facility. And it's, I think that how we started the whole event kind of crystallizes how we're working. We give farmers the podium, their testimonies, how they work, and we're trying to support their organizations and all the agri agencies like mine, FFD from Finland. We have a mandating farm organization. So we build on this peer support that Thierry was so nicely putting together. Because we think that in order to get the farmers to change their practices and change the whole system that they're using to use the natural resources, the best is to have their peers to support them. And that's what we're trying to do. When we talk about climate change, we talk about very complex words. We talk a lot about the data, science-based, nature-based solutions. This doesn't happen in the head of farmers. Farmer thinks about what are the natural resources in his disposal, how he can work with them, what are the reasons for him to change the way he's practicing. Since the farmers are already experiencing the effects of climate change, everybody is motivated to do the change. But these nature-based solutions usually require two things. They require more working hours and they require more knowledge. We have exchanged some ideas with Esther before that more you diversify your farm,
more you need different kind of a technical support that normally the extensionists don't have. And this is something that comes recurrently up when you discuss with farmers, how would like they build their resilience? They would like to get more knowledge, extension that is up to the point, looking for new solutions, how to work with natural resources in a different way. And when they see climate experts who come and present all these glossy new practices, it's difficult for them to see themselves practicing that. And that's what we're doing with building resilient exercises, is really we show them that they actually have all the knowledge they need. We have to experiment together with them and we learn these new solutions together. Finally, I think that what we have heard often when we discuss with the organizations from the ground is that we need new financial architecture to get people to practice and become climate actors. At the moment, I think about less than 2% of all climate funding reaches the smallholders. This shows that the mechanism doesn't work. We need new kind of funds that allow farmers to start changing their practices without going through 2 years of different kind of studies and analysis providing data. Data is interesting, but that is not what farmers need. Farmers need support, peer support, knowledge, possibilities to test, maybe fail, and to have a buffer behind them so that they can change their things. And I think that these kind of funds are starting to appear. I think that with Indigenous people, we have some emerging things. I hope that Chris will explore those. I think that we have to also think about financial flows, the agricultural subsidies. You know, maybe we could use them differently. Maybe we should think how we use them to support the transition and changes that we need in front of us. And I think that in all this, we should have farmers and their organizations not as objectives or objects. We should have them as subjects, actors, deciding themselves, proposing themselves, and therefore we have to bring the climate discourse to their level, empower them to act, and I hope that we can together discuss how this will be done. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina. And you almost introduced the next speaker, Chris Buss from EUCN. So Chris will comment on the main intervention by farmers, main action, and also how to mobilize the right funding. Two questions in 5 minutes.
Two questions in 5 minutes. I think that start with the second question of mobilizing the right finance. I think just taking a step back, and as Tina started alluding to, I think the difference between COP26 and COP27 is agriculture was a secondary conversation. I was even on Finance Day, I was involved in a panel that was virtually outside the building, but it had key farmer actors involved in that. But I think what you're seeing now in just the space of a year, that agriculture is center in some of the climate change solutions, and I think that's critical. I think in response to that is we've seen Indigenous peoples groups who are also supported by the Forest and Farm Facility, which supports Tina outlined the capacity building, but there's also a strong policy component of global involvement in global policy, regional policy, national policy, and working with various organizations at those levels to influence change, and drive process. And I think what we're seeing with the Indigenous Peoples Movement now is they're front and center in everything that's involved. They're involved in the regenerative agricultural discussions. They're involved in the renewables discussions because of all the impact in there. They're involved in everything. They've had a very strong messaging. And that's fantastic. And they're leading the way. But now I think it's now farmers' turn to be able to step up and influence that change. So I use that example because there's we saw last year in Glasgow, 1.7 billion committed to Indigenous peoples and local communities. Now, I suppose our ambition is to start moving that to farmers as well at all different levels. But if you have conversations on the sidelines here of that 1.7 billion, not much of it has actually flowed. I mean, the World Bank has the Forest Investment Programme, Climate Change Investment Funds, dedicated grant mechanism for Indigenous peoples and local communities. But we need to be building on those models, and that's where the Forest and Farm Facility is helping drive access to farmers and money to farmers so they can access those funds. And I think that's the critical thing is making that decision. Is allowing farmers to have that decision to access funds rather than top-down delivery of finance. But I think when we also talk about finance, I don't know, I'll just talk from the UK, although I haven't lived there for 25 years. But anyway, following the politics, you always hear this conversation of, well, we have to be very careful with taxpayers' money. And okay, but what have we just done in the last 2 years? We've just thrown trillions at COVID with no fiduciary responsibility. But then when it comes to ODA, all of a sudden on 2 million, there's all sorts of fiduciary regulations where we haven't seen that in COVID responses. But for some reason, when it goes out and we want to get finance to farmers, that doesn't really happen. So, I think to me, that those are the sort of critical responses to your questions in how we start thinking about mobilizing finance and making sure it gets to the right place, but also that farmers are responsive, can access those funds under their terms and conditions rather than the other way around.
Thank you, Chris. And I think one point that is very important is recognition to farmer recognition. I'm a farmer. We work a lot to improve our practices, but it's not always known, and the recognition is not always there. So the next speaker is Kelly Witowski, AICA Manager Climate Change Program. So how NDCs, okay, can be an opportunity for government to collaborate further with farmers' organization?
Thank you. I mean, I'm so impressed sitting here listening to the three farmers we have on this panel. And this is of the wide variety of measures they're already taking to build resilience to climate change. I mean, we must have heard at least 20 here, from, you know, biogas to green manure to crop rotation to diversified integrated systems. And when I think about the local knowledge and the effort that farmers are putting in and compare that to some of the perceptions of agriculture at the international level, it's really quite a stark contrast. And so I very much agree with what you said, that it's fundamental for agriculture to be front and center of these discussions. And first of all, for farmers to be there talking about what they actually need, the advances that they're making, but also really discussing the challenges, especially when we're talking about implementing climate policy. In particular, from a mitigation standpoint, which doesn't necessarily benefit the farmer directly, but is something that the world needs, and in which in turn farmers are affected by on the front lines of climate change. The nationally determined contributions are a public policy document, and like other public policies, what really depends on is the implementation. I think one of the differences with NDCs is that it's a cyclical process. So this is something countries have to update every 5 years. The first ones came out in 2020, so 2025. And then starting in 2023, there's a process called the global stocktake, where every country has to report back on their progress. And so 3 points I want to make. One is, in climate action, there's different roles based on the scale of the challenge. Farmers taking all the actions that they can't solve the entire problem. There's things like access to finance, de-risking, because change is a really risky process. So how do we take the burden of that risk off farmers and place it onto all of us that want to eat every day? You know, things like insurance. Those are things that at an individual farmer scale or even at a farmer's organization scale are very hard to do. And so that's where the different roles, I think, come in terms of actually implementing the NDC, which is my second point. Almost all of the NDCs in the world include agriculture. We recently did an analysis in Latin America and the Caribbean of how the agricultural elements are being implemented. And to make it very short, essentially, we're falling short. They're not being implemented. And part of this has been because farmers haven't been as fundamentally involved in the process as they need to be. If we want the action on the ground, it has to be working through farmers' organizations to do that. And I think you mentioned organization is a really key point. And that's a way that I think, or a fundamental enabling condition of actually moving the needle on the ground where we need it to happen, so far away from the talk that we do at these international negotiations. Also in terms of digitalization and co-innovation, we really need to move quickly. And without that co-innovation, everybody working together to find solutions that work in every local context, we're not going to be able to accelerate the implementation and the pace of change that we need. And so I think governments have to use this opportunity and the finance that's coming along with it to really drive towards locally led adaptation, especially in agriculture, implementing and providing decision-making authority at the lowest level possible to really move forward. And the third part where I think this really requires government coordination better with farmers organizations is on the monitoring, reporting, and evaluation, not just for greenhouse gas inventories or for reporting back, but so that we can really better understand the impact. A lot of the issues we're working on in terms of resilience building are linked to basic vulnerability. So with or without climate change, they're there and climate change is making it worse. And we've been working on development in agriculture for many, many years. And so how can we take advantage of this opportunity, the climate finance, and the attention that the world is paying towards actually implementing and reporting on the adaptation and mitigation commitments made in the NDCs to actually start to move the needle and better understand that impact. So finally, just real quick from ICA's perspective, there's a couple of things we're doing about that. One, for example, is facilitating this pavilion space because as my colleague from IUCN said, agriculture hasn't really had an active role in negotiations. There's been lots of talk about agriculture and what agriculture should do, but not necessarily from the actors, from the sector itself, and even less from the farmers. And so we wanted to provide this space for agriculture to have a greater voice and visibility in these discussions. And secondly, we're working on a GCF project, a readiness project in the Caribbean, that we're using the readiness funds, which are for preparation, to raise awareness about climate, the GCF and climate processes and the programming processes in general, and not only raise awareness, but build capacity for the sector to intervene in a more informed and organized manner so that we can actually start to drive greater climate finance to the sector with a solid evidence base and build institutional capacity along the way. Thank you.
Sorry, John. Thank you, Kelly. So before I give the word to Gabriella for the closing remark, do you have question one, question two, or two to each other?
You're looking at me, Marcel.
Yeah, no,
putting me on the spot.
I have a few questions too. My question, we have three farmers from three different continents. Their issues are very different from each other. There are seven farmers that have put their farm together in order to be more efficient. On the other side, we have small farmers that need to adapt, need to develop new practices, two different ways to manage climate change and action. So is it one that is better than the others, or why do you merge your farm together? Just for efficacy or labor or what?
Um,
First of all, we wanted to be more resilient. And resilient. And the best way to be resilient is around the soil. And when you have a living soil, it's more easier to be resilient, no more erosion. When you have big rain, it's possible to cap the rain. You can't use less fertilizers, and you can use less pesticide, of course. And when it's very warm, when it's very cold, it's more resilient. And sure, it's not enough to have a living soil, but for me, it's one the best way to more resilient. And it's easier to regeneration, to have a to regenerate a soil. It takes only a few years. You have to change the techniques. You have to use more manure. You have to use more vegetable legumes, and you have to diversify the rotation. And this, with living soil, you get more resilience. This is the best way.
And for small farmers, how do you answer the market? How do you respond to the market? Because the market is growing. How do you respond to that? How do you work collectively to?
Yes, actually in AFA, we promote the building and strengthening of farmers' cooperatives. Because we know that many farmers are just mere price takers. They cannot dictate the prices of our products.
No.
But when we are collectively, like selling our produce, or collectively processing our produce, and collectively distributing it and marketing it, we earn more. And especially through cooperatives, because cooperatives are structures that provide dividends and patronage funds. So there is equal sharing of profit. So this is the way to go for us, to really build cooperatives. And we have, we start with forming commodity clusters so that they will have the mindset, the encouragement, and then build their capacity so that they could manage their cooperatives.
And I think Chris have a...
Yeah, I think I just want to echo Kelly's words. I sit here with three farmers and totally not a farmer. So what we're hearing is we're hearing from farmers. And then you've got Thierry on agroecological approaches, Esther talking about organization. So that just to me just demonstrates the complexity of different interventions and different financing needs. And I think in from just hearing that conversation is and both responses is we need to be responsive to that. We need to listen to the farmer, you know, because it's very easy. Normally what we do with top-down funds, it comes out, we're going to do this. Are you interested? Oh, we'll try and do it. And then it doesn't happen. I mean, look what's happened with ODA over many years. There's been many examples of wasted funds. So yeah, we've got to put farmers in when Tina talks about finance and funds to the farmers have to be decision makers to that finance, to drive it where it's needed, to make sure it's happening. And I think that needs to be the step change. If you look at the Indigenous Peoples Dedicated Grant Mechanism at the World Bank that I mentioned earlier, they are the decision makers behind that. They're the governance, they're driving that. And we need the same mechanisms for farmers as well. And Kelly is going to also jump in as well.
I did have a question for my fellow panelists, but before that, I wanted to mention yesterday on a panel, Harry Clark from New Zealand said that for every complex problem, of which climate change is certainly a wicked one, there's a very simple solution that's invariably wrong. And, you know, listening to the farmers, I think, is one really easy way to fix that and make sure we get it right at first. But a question I had for the three of you is, what do you say to your fellow farmers in your region when they're more slower on making changes, when they're afraid to make the changes that you guys are making to create your more resilient systems? How do you speak? How do you talk to them?
Anyone answer from Uganda?
Mm-hmm. Well, the case with Uganda, let me say specifically Masindisi Farmer Association. This is a farmer organization. Farmers are organized at parish levels, and we base in interest groups. We have farmers in various enterprises, so they have those interest groups, and eventually we converge and make an association. But we base on demands. Our service provider comes with our demand on certain issue that we are facing a challenge with, and basically that's what we do.
Yeah. Esther?
Yes, farmers are very cautious, no? Because if they take the risk and they lose much, much more. No? So what we do is to really listen to them first, know their concerns, know their questions, and then show and tell. Show and tell. So for farmers, it is to see is to believe. Like if I see my neighbor had income from tomatoes, I will plant tomatoes next planting season. So it's like that. To see is to believe. So in APA, now we do a lot of learning exchanges, as well as encouraging them and accompanying them to do videos and to do case studies. And we have this platform, a website, and Facebook that they can go to, not to learn from this. So it's really basically listen, show, and tell, and accompany them in the process. So farmer extension is very important, because farmer would want to approach someone very easily if he had a pest in his farm, she had a problem in his farm, she needs quick help. And that's why a model of our farming of our member in SEWA is very effective, because SEWA, Self-Employed Women's Association, with 2 million women, all women members, they train master trainers in a village of like a radius of 20 kilometers. And this master trainer goes back, when she is trained, goes back to the field and then provides extension services to the others. And then if the farmer is able to get that service, she pays to the master trainer. So it's a very good self generating income, no, for the master trainer. And we hope that we could also have this kind of model replicated in other countries.
Thank you, Esther. And Thierry?
Yes, everywhere in the world, farmers are afraid to change. And it's more easier to change not alone. It's why farmers' organization in France, everywhere in the world, is the same. It's easier to begin to change something. Economics first, in most of the places. Environmental. Many people are conscious of this because climate change. And also social, because they want a new way of life with adaptation and maybe mitigation of climate change.
So the answer is mainly through their farmers organization. That's the way they all evolve together, and they share information, knowledge, and they sell together the product to improve their living. So thank you to everyone. Then I will let Gabriella for the closing, say the closing remark. And I want to thanks all of you for your times and experience, sharing experience in these panel. Gabriella.
Thank you, Marcel, and thank you, everybody, for joining us. I guess it was actually a very interesting and inspiring side event for all of us. I'm not going to repeat the ideas that everybody shared, but maybe a few takeaways for you to bring it home and to take it and share it with your fellow colleagues. I think that we've heard that the transition is already happening. Farmers are organized, they're adapting. It is very important to recognize their role. More and more we're hearing that every time a discussion is happening around agriculture, we want them around the table to be together with us. The examples that they brought to us today are not only inspiring, but this can be scaled up. We need more interaction between Africa, Latin America, Asia, Europe, and furthermore. It is very important. We need to learn also from these lessons and continue building the capacities for the farmers to continue strengthen and forming cutting-edge partnerships. All of them showed in different ways that we cannot do it alone. We have to have different strategic partners to work with, to have trust, bonding, and in that way to continue empower each other. Someone said also that the financial architecture needs to change to reach the smallholder farmers. It really needs to get to the right place. And this is the discussions that we're having here at COP27. And we encourage ourselves to go further about that. NDCs, it seems that for the farmers, it is really an opportunity that we probably need to dig in. The examples that were brought here can encourage indeed the finding of the different solutions in collaboration with different sectors. So just to end, we thank you a lot for being in the panel. We thank you, Yika, to host us and provide the space for having this dialogue. And we take the opportunity to invite you also for the 11th, where we're going to have another panel as well to keep discussing these issues. And please, to be together with us. Thanks a lot.